We have a condition of austerity, and I think this is across the public sector. I'm just using Gauteng Health Department as emblematic of what is going on across the public sector. So it feels like austerity, but at the same time, there is no consolidation. So if you look at fiscal policy over the last 25 years, you have the, if I look at primary spending, which is this green line as a share of GDP, and I've excluded from this green line debt service costs, also financial transactions, which is bailouts to Eskom and any other public enterprises, because I want to get a sense of what is the operational budget, the fundamental commitments of the public service to delivery. So you see during the GEAR period, there was a dramatic curtailment of primary spending. That went together with very tough political decisions that were made that were very controversial at the time. Lowering, retrenching a whole lot of staff, voluntary severance packages. There was a real contraction in service provision. And I'm going to come back to that point again. And I'm not saying that's a right thing to do at the time. The point is that the fiscal policy choices were backed by broader policy choices that enabled the fiscal policy to achieve this contraction in spending. But from about 2000, you had a massive expansion in the size of the public service. And again, this is not something that is related to state capture. No, a policy decision was made at the time that South Africa, in order to grow, needs better defense against crime. It needs better education. It needs better health. So a decision was taken to massively expand the size of the police officers on duty, to expand the number of nurses and doctors, to expand the number of teachers. And that's what drove that rise in expenditure up until about 2008, the global crisis. Of course, at the time, because of the factors that Gina alluded to, revenue was also rising. So it looked like this would be a sustainable position. But after the 2008 crisis, 9 crisis, revenue collapsed. And clearly since then, this gap opened up between the, what we call the primary deficit, between primary spending and revenue. Now, I want to dispel a myth that is often reported in the media, which is that expenditure has been out of control. Expenditure has not been out of control, at least primary expenditure has not been out of control. As you see, this line has remained more or less stable as a share of GDP. While expenditure during the period 2000 to 2010 was increasing at a rate of about 10% in real terms, 10% after inflation every year over that period, since the global crisis, growth in expenditure has been brought down almost to converge with CPI inflation. So expenditure for the last decade has been stable, but, or primary expenditure has been stable. But of course, you've had a deficit because revenue collapsed, and so therefore total expenditure has been increasing rapidly. But the driver of that increase in total expenditure has been interest payments. The response of government until 2016 was to, The thing that was helping us move in a right direction until 2016 was not curtailment of expenditure, but rising tax revenue. And there was a very strange phenomenon during this period, that nominal growth was decelerating sharply year after year. But for some reason, taxes remained extremely buoyant. There was a surge in tax buoyancy in the period from 2011 up until 2016. So GDP overall, I mean, taxes overall were growing much faster than the economy. And this is at a time, partly because government was raising, was making tax policy interventions, raising the personal income tax rates, introducing a new bracket, raising taxes, raising the fuel levy. Later on, we raised VAT. But this rise, this tax buoyancy, is not really explained by policy. In my view, it is explained by fundamental underlying conditions of buoyant conditions, buoyant compensation conditions in the elite private sector. So despite the economic deceleration, You had a financial sector boom in the wake of quantitative easing. You had huge bonuses, huge rises in asset prices around the world, which translated into huge improvements in NASPER's bottom line, et cetera, which resulted in a hugely buoyant tax take. The debate at the time is, does this new buoyancy mean that we are in a new normal of a more buoyant tax arrangement, tax structure? Or does it mean that there's some temporary factors that are making tax buoyant that will come to an end and we will fall off the cliff? It turned out the second was right. So in my view, what happened there when in 2016, because up until about 2016, we were on the right track. We were containing expenditure, revenue was rising and buoyant, and it looked like we were going to close the primary balance and stabilize debt despite the deceleration of growth. But from 2016, tax revenue started to move in the other direction. A number of factors explain that in my view, including asset prices, the exchange rate, and conditions in the labor market, particularly the top end of the labor market. So in my view, the collapse of taxation has very little to do with state capture or problems in SARS, particularly because it's concentrated in personal income tax, which is a highly automated process which has inertia behind it. So whatever administrative problems there might be at SARS, you wouldn't expect them on the face of it to translate. Maybe if you close the large business unit, you might expect an impact in corporate tax. Obviously, in VAT, there was the whole question of the refunds. But the real driver of the fall in tax revenue has been personal income tax. And in my view, that is much more to do with underlying economic conditions than some effect of state capture. So the crisis, the fiscal crisis we entered into, really started in 2016 once that finished. So I've kind of explained this. But just to underscore it, the green line is the nominal growth in personal income tax revenue. The shaded line, sorry, wrong button. The shaded line is the nominal GDP growth. So you would expect, so the buoyancy of taxes is the difference between those two lines, essentially. So you can see that in this period, 2012 to about 2015, there was a massive boom in personal income tax buoyancy. And it's not a surprise that the distance between these two lines converged. It's not a surprise that they converged after 2016. What is a surprise is that why did we have this boom in personal income tax revenue, which has not really been explained. So, what else happened? On the expenditure side, and it goes back to what I'm saying on the health department, essentially, while maintaining an overall expenditure ceiling and ensuring that expenditure is well contained, government has been unable to contain the growth of wage costs. So wages have increased in the public service, and I'll come back to this. So for a nurse who's been employed for 11 years in the public service has seen a wage gain in real terms on average every year of 6%. For the last 10 years, right? Now again, the argument is not that nurses don't deserve better wages. The argument is that we have an inconsistent policy stance because we have not funded that increase in wages. We agreed to an occupation-specific dispensation which led to a 35% wage gain, but the budget did not accommodate that. So the expenditure was contained at the top while costs were allowed to rise from the bottom. And the inevitable consequence of that has been that headcounts have been forced to stabilize. So the number of full-time employees in the public service has been constant since about 2012. Now, the number of people needing services from the public service has not been constant. So learner-educator ratios are rising, eroding the quality of the public education system. The police force is understaffed. The health system, as I've showed, cannot increase its employment. And so that picture means a real erosion of service delivery felt by those people who don't have access to private health, education, and security services, which is the vast majority of the population. So where are we now? There is no consolidation. There is no consolidation plan. We'll see next week, Wednesday, about the 150 billion or the 50 billion and all of this. But this is the data from the MTBPS. Again, I'm saying adjusted because it's excluding ESCOM bailouts and all of that kind of stuff. It's just looking at the core deficit, right? And essentially, we've been in a deficit somewhere between 4 and 6% for the last decade, and the MTBPS said it's not going to change. It's going to stay there, right? So the best I would imagine that could be done in the MTBPS is a slight reduction in the size of these deficits. That might be possible. But basically, we have a permanent structural fiscal deficit at 5 or 6% of GDP. And the structural nature of it can be seen in the balance between the primary balance and the overall balance. So remember that that difference is debt service costs. So the dark part is debt service costs. So while progress was being made in closing the primary balance, which is the deficit in the funding of core government services, the deficit remained at 5 or 6% because debt service costs were rising. And of course, debt is a problem. I want to make another important distinction. People often debate about the level of debt and say, well, South Africa's debt is only 50, 60% of GDP. In Japan, it's 200%. In America, it's this. And somewhere else, it's that. That's not the issue. The issue is the trajectory. The trajectory of debt continues to go up. And the trajectory of debt is what can lead to a debt crisis. If debt was stable, a flat line at 80%, I don't think anyone would be worried. The problem is that debt is rising year after year, and each year that it rises, it raises the risk of a sudden macroeconomic shock because of change in sentiment.